So I put the other recorded lectures up online. If you're a commuter, I did this when I actually went to undergrad out in California and had to drive to go to school. I lived in San Francisco and I went to school in Berkeley, and I would listen to my lectures, like, you know, that my professors had given. I asked permission to record them. I'd record them for you, so like you can have them if you want them, okay? And that helped me to sort of, I'm a very oral person. I like to hear things that I get a lot of pleasure from listening. So that's the way I do well, is I kind of combine the listening and the reading, two forms of pleasure. Okay, don't need this, I need this one. Quiz on Thursday, it will be on the first generation of Romantic poets. There's your first generation, Blake, Wordsworth, and Coleridge. Everything that you need to know is gonna be up there. And let's see. Okay, and I said that I'll have the blackboards updated. I've updated all but today's. I'll put today's up there. They're already up on Carmen. And then you'll need your own notes. So if you're a good note taker, that's a good thing. It'll help you. If you're not a good note taker and you know somebody else in class who's a good note taker, I would get their notes and kind of compile them. Or you can trade, yes.
Will there be any background on the authors, and should we know about them?
No, anything that you need to know, I'll have mentioned it in class. So you don't need, I'm not gonna ask you dates of birth or anything like that. I'm not gonna ask you too many dates, period, all right? I'll just ask you to move through. So today, you should be working with the packet that looks like this. But there's one poem I want to do from the end of the other packet, the one that, I don't know what it looks like. I think I gave them all away. Yes, I do. It looks like, it looks like this, with infant joy as the first thing. Right? So the poem at the back called by Charlotte Smith, called Written at the Close of Spring. So I wanted to do this because, as I said right above here, or I wrote, that these poets, Blake, Wordsworth, and Coleridge, they built their poetic movement not only on women poets, but also on women poets, especially there's three you should think of. And I'm not going to quiz you on this, so don't worry. I mean, I've actually only given you Charlotte Smith, so I only really care that you really get Charlotte Smith down, but I'll tell you who the others are in case you want to go back and read them. Mary Robinson, excellent poet. Anna Barbauld, actually I did give you Anna Barbauld, to a little invisible being who is expected soon to become visible. Long title, right? It's in there. And then, I only know the whole title because I wrote about it. But and the other one is, of course, Charlotte Smith. Mary Robinson, Anna Barbauld, and Charlotte Smith. Three really important poets for the our poets, for Wordsworth, Coleridge, and Blake. Especially for Wordsworth and Coleridge, they really were inspired by these women poets, because these women poets didn't like focus primarily on being witty or smart or clever. They focused on sensation, on being in the world and being sensually connected to the world. And you'll notice that in this poem by Charlotte Smith, that aspect of sensual connection is really present, okay? So I'll read it, it's a sonnet. Usually, for those of you who have not taken a lot of English classes in the past, a sonnet is almost always 14 lines, and I say almost always because there's a great Victorian poet who wrote shorter sonnets, Jared Manley Hopkins, and we'll come to him later in the semester, but usually they're 14 lines, and what they allow for is, why are sonnets so productive? Because they act like little thinking machines or feeling machines. They're very compact little units of feeling and thought. So if you like pop music, you might ask yourself, how come these pop songs are all 3 or 4 or 5 minutes long? Why aren't they 10 or 20 minutes long? Well, it's because it's a convention. It started, and what happens is once it becomes a convention,
there's a lot you can get out of working with a convention. It actually can free you up to do stuff that no one has ever done before. So you change a little thing here, like, I don't know, well, a lot of rappers that I like, they will leave the mic open for before the rap comes in, and you'll hear a lot of the first takes and whatever, and that becomes part of what they do. A kind of, who am I thinking of? Vince Staples' first record is sort of like this. POS is sort of like this. Lots of like sound in there. Once it happens, it's in there, and it becomes part of like the way that form works. So the pop song form and the sonic form are really related in so far as they give us a way of working. So usually they are rhymed. Yes, like this. This one is rhymed in a Shakespearean fashion. A B A B A B C D C D E F E F G G. All right. Does anybody not know what I mean when I say those letters? Be honest, because it's fine. Yeah, good. Thank you. What I mean is, I'm saying each time you have an end word that's going to have a rhyme sound, it's going to rhyme with one of the other lines. So what you do to figure out what the rhyme scheme is you put an A before the first sound that comes up, and that's wove. So that's A. The next one is do. Now, do doesn't sound like wove, so it gets a B. Then grove sounds like wove, right? So it gets the A again. And blue sounds like do, so it gets the B again. Now, del doesn't sound like any of them. It's a new sound, so it gets the C. And then plain, again, gets the D, and then C, and then D. And again, the word again really doesn't sound like plain, but you give the poet that. It's a cheat, right? Again, right? Again instead of again, right? And then E, D, E, F, E, F, sorry, that should be E, F, and then G, G. And this final thing is called a couplet. Okay, that's the way sonnets work when they are in the Shakespearean form. Don't worry about this, I'm not gonna question you on it, but I do want you to get that rhyme stuff. Do you know why? For your close reading papers. When you do a close reading paper, you're gonna talk about sound patterning. I don't care if you get all the terms correct, I don't care, you know, I'm really interested in that you're using your ear, your inner ear, to hear. Now, David Hartley, the great 18th century philosopher, he said that when we read quietly and we don't read aloud, we still hear the sounds. I agree with him, especially when we read poetry. I hear the sounds in my head. So even if I'm not reading them aloud, it's an aural kind of thing. It's mediated through the eye. In other words, it goes through the eye, but it comes to the ear. And the ear is what does the understanding. Yes?
The sonnet is five stresses and five unstresses. That's
a great question. Yes, normally it will be five stresses, five unstresses. Usually in an unstressed stress pattern called iambic pentameter. So usually that's the stress patterning. I'm not so interested in that, but it is really interesting if you're doing a close reading paper, we'll get to this, is if there's an anomaly, if there's a place where the poet changes that up a lot. Like you'll hear when we do Coleridge, when we did Coleridge, he says that thin blue flame, when he's talking about the little thing on the grate, the thin blue flame, that's three stresses in a row. That's like crazy, man. You know, it doesn't sound that crazy to us now, but for the line, it's really upsetting. And the thing to do is to focus on when you find those, what the feeling is for the reader. It's usually a kind of intensity or a kind of heightened tension or something like that that you can talk about when you're writing your close reading papers. I know it sounds subtle, but it's like if you're watching somebody very quietly, every little movement of their face becomes important. And that's what it's like in a poem. Every little like change becomes important. So let's go ahead and do this one. The garlands fade that spring so lately wove, each simple flower which she had nursed in dew, anemones that spangled every grove, the primrose wan, the harebell mildly blue. No more shall violets linger in the dell, or purple orchids variegate the plain, till spring again shall call forth every bell and dress with human hands her wreaths again. Ah, poor humanity, so frail, so fair, so fair are the fond visions of thy early day, till tyrant passion and corrosive care bid all thy fairy colors fade away. Another May, new buds and flowers shall spring. Ah, why has happiness no second spring?
Okay, so this is a kind of old-fashioned-y poem to us now. We're kind of like, it seems kind of old-fashioned. But it was pretty radical at the time, and I'll tell you why. Because she immediately talks about, fading of beauty that you see in nature, right? Beauty fades, like the whole first eight lines, really, or the first two, we would call them two quatrains, the first two quatrains, they build up this story about these flowers and how they fade away. They don't look so beautiful again. But then she suddenly switches. Ah, poor humanity. And that should immediately ring a bell. You should go, wait a minute. This poem written in 1794, Wordsworth writes lines written in early spring in 1798, and he says, what man has made of man? Have I not reason to lament what man has made of man? Huh, that sounds kind of like Charlotte Smith. I wonder if he was reading Charlotte Smith, right? It's not a copy like that. It's more like it gets in your head and you just have it running in there, right? Just like a sample. It just comes out, right? It's just like a thing. So it's in there. Ah, poor humanity, so frail, so fair are the fond visions of thy fair day. So what happens is that, right, you get the conceit of the poem, that you get the trick of the poem, right? It's flowers fade, but they get to have a second spring. I, a late 18th century woman, who by the way had some man problems, I fade, but I don't get a second spin. I don't get reborn again in that way, right? Why has happiness no second spring? So it's a pretty cool poem. I wanted to give it to you because it seems really messed up that I haven't assigned more poems by women. I'm just trying to cover the big poets of the period. And for different reasons, we don't read these poets as much. I think it has to do with what I was saying before. The kind of subtlety of their poetry almost escapes us a little bit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any questions about this or about the sonnet form in general? The idea of the couplet is it's supposed to be a kind of enclosed message. Like if you read just the couplet, you should be able to understand the larger arguments of the rest of the poem. That's the idea of the Shakespearean sonnet. It's not always true, but largely that's what tends to happen. All right, if there are no questions, then we'll move on to the packet for today. All right, so let me show you something. I'm just gonna go on the internet and just like, don't worry, nothing weird. I'm just going to go on the internet and find me a poem by Alexander Pope. Why are you looking for a poem by Alexander Pope? Oops, Alexander Pope. Why, Professor Ruderman, are you looking for a poem by Alexander Pope? Because what the Romantics were pushing back against, in the same way that punk rock pushed back against Electric Light Orchestra or whatever, or like REO Speedwagon. You know, the reason they pushed back against overly clean pop music is the same reason why Wordsworth and Coleridge pushed back against Alexander's Pope's like overly clever and always rhymey, chimey poems. Now,
I have a confession to make.
I love Pope. I think he's a great poet. But this is what you do when you come along and you try to create a movement. You say, you know, to the movement that came before you, that's what you do. And then you cry to your own, you go, yeah, you know, whatever. But it's important to do that. This historically, it's important. But you'll see why. So let's just look at almost any lines from Pope will do, because they're almost all written in what's called heroic couplets. Those are rhyming A, B, B, C, C, D, D, like that, and ad infinitum. So I walked along and saw the pretty rose. I thought about the thing until I dozed. I da-da-da-da-da-da-da sky. I da-da-da-da-da-da-da cried. Right? So it goes like that on and on and on. Now, he handles it wonderfully because he's an amazing poet. But this is what they're pushing back against. And you'll see in a minute why Wordsworth says it quite. Come on, I want the poems. I don't want to hear about him. Poems. At the top, there were poems?
Yeah, right by the word says Poetry Foundation.
You think so? Those would be the poems? No, see, that's not his poem. So I think his poems are going to be at the bottom. Thank you, though. All right. In these deep solitudes and awful cells, where heavenly pensive contemplation dwells, and ever musing melancholy reigns, what means this tumult in thy vestal veins? Rive over my thoughts of thus last retreat, while feels my heart's its long forgotten heat. Da 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 da. Right? And is it about somebody he knows? No. It's about a relationship in an antiquity, right? So the poems tended to be about famous people who died centuries ago. The poems tended to be about really witty things meant for other witty people, mostly really high-class people read these poems. And Wordsworth and Coleridge, who had left the city and were living in the country, were like, no, 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 we're going to write poems that everybody can kind of understand. Now, we read them and we go, well, that doesn't sound that understandable to us. But that's partly because we're in the 21st century and a lot of stuff has happened. Trust me, he would not understand, you know, he would not understand Kanye West, you know. He'd go, what? No, I don't get it, you know. So it's like it's all different, right? Do you get the point of what he was about? What, you know, right? So the great poems, like The Rape of the Lock, etc., but they're all really fanciful, set off in some kind of woods somewhere with knights and everything like that. Okay. All right, so let's go ahead. Whoops, this is not the one I want. I want this one. Okay. I don't want that. I want this. Okay. All right, so just pick up this, and I'm going to read a little bit. So let me, again, say about this. So this collection called the Lyrical Ballads is one of the most important poetry collections written in English, right? And why? It was co-authored by these two guys, William Wordsworth and Samuel Taylor Coleridge. They get together and they decide, we're going to write this book of poems and we're going to make it about everyday experience. And when it's not about, so let me step back for a second. Has anybody heard of a poem called Rime of the Ancient Mariner? One person? Okay. So if I were teaching this class and had more time, you would absolutely read Rime of the Ancient Mariner, which is written by Coleridge. And it is the very first poem in this collection. And if you read it, you go, well, wait a minute. This is a story about a mariner who goes off on some crazy thing and gets, and everybody dies, and he turns into some kind of weird, like, well, the albatross comes around. He kills an albatross, and like all kinds of things happen on this ship, and he ends up becoming kind of a haunted figure. And you'd say, well, wait a minute, that's not about everyday life. But what Wordsworth and Coleridge agreed upon was that they would write about, that Wordsworth would write poems about everyday life and show how really unique and strange everyday life is. And Coleridge would write poems about supernatural things and show how psychologically basic and simple it is. Does that make any sense? That like in the supernatural stories before, you didn't have somebody who psychologically suffered the same way we do. And so he does that. So that's the way they get the supernatural in there. But for the most part, the idea was to write poems that anybody that read English could understand, that most people could understand anyway. All right. And the first edition, 1798, is published anonymously. And the second, 1800, this is when he writes the preface. Wordsworth writes it himself. Coleridge, at this point, Coleridge is not long for collaboration. He's like, I'm on just some opium and some other things. I'm out, you know? And so, like, Wordsworth continued on. And for me, these guys, I love these guys, so you'll get that already. These are like my Lennon and McCartney. These are my two guys, right? Okay. All right. He writes the preface, and at that point, they put their names on it. They put their names on it. Everyone figured out anyway. They knew who wrote them, right? And it was a very small readership at first. It grew over time, but a very small readership at first. All right, so in the first preface to the Lyrical Ballads, this is what he wrote. So you can kind of follow along now with your handout, okay? The principal object, then, which I proposed to myself in these poems was to choose incidents and situations from common life and to relate or describe them throughout as far as was possible in a selection of language really used by men, and at the same time to throw over them a certain coloring of imagination whereby ordinary things should be presented to the mind in an unusual way. This is what I was talking about. And further, and to above all, to make these incidents and situations interesting by tracing in them, truly though not ostentatiously, the primary laws of our nature. Chiefly, as far as regards the manner in which we associate ideas in a state of excitement, low and rustic life was generally chosen, because in that condition, the essential passions of the heart find a better soil which they can attain their maturity. They're less under restraint. They speak a plainer and more emphatic language. Because in that condition of life, our elementary feelings coexist in a state of greater simplicity and consequently may be more accurately contemplated and more forcefully communicated. So rural life, low and rustic life, by that he means workers. Those are the things. Now why? Why does he not write about, rich people in mansions or whatever? Because he feels that when someone is living a life of, and remember, this is right at that moment of the Industrial Revolution where some people were still living on the land, and some people were starting to transition into factory work, into trade, into other forms of labor. This did not happen easily, by the way. This transition was very, very hard. Over 200,000 hand loom weavers starved to death during this time period. These are people who had made their living for generations in their own cottages, weaving cloth that would then be sold and be able to buy the foodstuffs they need to keep going, right, and raise their families. But with the invention of the power loom, this was no longer needed, right? a number of professions like this, a number of things like this. We had the same kind of issues at different places. You can read novels from later in the century, Thomas Hardy's Test of the Dubervilles or Return of the Native also talks about what happens when the cotton gin comes along. And cotton pickers no longer, right, can no longer make their living, right? So people who had made their living by very basic means can no longer do it. And that's what happens. The idea, though, is that those people that had the very basic kinds of feelings and whatever, they were somehow more poetic. They were more honest in their feelings, more honest in their expressions, and somehow this allowed for a greater poetic thing to take place. So let me go back, and I want you to really get this, so please, if either take notes or whatever you need to do to sort of get this part. Basically, there are three things that I want you to get from the preface to the Lyrical Ballads, okay? One, three claims in the preface to the Lyrical Ballads. The first is common language. It should be written in the language of everyday speech for everyday people. Two, situations from everyday life. So these are almost like rules that he sets himself, not for all poetry, mind you, but for this collection, okay? A common language, everyday life. And finally, third, poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful emotions. Now, I want you to put a little asterisk by this, because he goes and says that although this is true, although it's true that poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful emotions, nothing that's any good could be written by somebody who hasn't thought long and deeply about something. Okay? So it's not enough to have a powerful overflow. It's not enough to explode your feelings in your journal. You have to have thought long and deeply about things so that when you do have that powerful overflow of feelings, you're able to do it. So that's like someone who thought long and deeply. Right? So I want you to get that. So it's powerful over emotions, but you must have thought long and deeply beforehand. I don't know if any of you like visual art, but I'm a big fan of painting especially. And you go to look at abstract paintings, and you look at painters like Mondrian. He's the guy that did the lines and the red and blue squares or whatever. And you're like, whoa, that's ridiculous. Anybody could do that, right? No, I mean, you have to look back at his whole building up to get to that point. He's an amazing draftsman, people. He could draw you perfectly. He could draw the most beautiful boats or flowers or whatever. But he was trying to take art to a new place. So same thing with, Jackson Pollock doesn't work because he actually wasn't a great natural painter, but he was just a weird genius. Willem de Kooning, if you ever looked at his work, just big brush strokes all over the canvas. And you're like, oh, come on, you know my kid could do it, blah, blah, blah. But look back at his work. He's an amazing detailed painter. He could paint like amazing still lifes or whatever. And the point was, he was trained as a painter so that when he had that spontaneous like movement, he had all of the technique of the painter behind him. Do you understand what I mean? His brushwork is fantastic. His ability to think about where the color should be is already innate inside of him because he's worked so hard at it for so long. But he doesn't get trapped up in something that feels overly worked over or thought through. Instead, there's that spontaneous feeling. That's what Wordsworth wants to get at. He's written so much, he's read so much, he's thought so long and deeply that when he gets that immediate idea, boom, it's out. Right? So, is anybody in here a musician? I should ask this question before. One, two, who else? Three.
three, four. Okay, the hands are very close. It's a little bit. Okay, now you're a musician if you play something. That's fine. Okay. So
you know that, like, when somebody improvises, if they just sit down to improvise and they've never learned the instrument, they don't know the positions, they haven't learned different modes or scales or licks or whatever, then it's pretty trashy, right? But if they've improvised and they've done all that stuff first, then they can really take off. And it's really exciting because they don't know where they're going and you don't know where they're going. When Wordsworth or Coleridge start a poem, they don't know where it's going to end up. You see how great that is? It's a spontaneous overflow of powerful emotions. But they've thought long and deep. They've practiced. They're in that space. They're like, you know, Coltrane's of poetry. They're ready. They're ready to just, like, whatever you throw at me, I'm going to play over this. I'm going to make something up. We're going to, boom, go, right? So that's the idea. They're trained enough. And it is largely true that they wrote super quick. Super quick. They did not take time to think that hard because they wanted to capture that immediacy, right? And you know the advantages of that. There are disadvantages, but there are definite advantages, okay? So are there any questions about this, about the preface to the lyrical ballads? Now, he says other things in here that are important to us, but I'm going to kind of not make a big point of it. He talks about that 18th century poetry, that the Pope that I talked about before. He says he's not going to write like that. He says he's going to do away with what he calls inane phraseology, right? Like overly flowery language, right? He's going to do away with really boring meters, right? He's going to try to do away with all that. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at, we're going to look at three poems by Wordsworth today. Let's look at We Are Seven first, okay? Hopefully, when you read this poem, this is a poem, for some reason, that many of you end up writing about. You are Caleb, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll read the first stanza, Caleb, and then you read the second.
Okay.
And then Max, right? And then Kristen. No, not Kristen, what's your name?
Ilya.
Ilya. It is Max, though, right?
Yeah.
Ilya, and what's your name?
Kristen,
there you're Kristen. Okay, we'll go this way, okay? And then that way. And each person read just one stanza and read it aloud. And most of these lines are end stops, so it's fine to give a little pause at the end of the line. Let's talk about what an end stop is for a second. An end stop is simply where the line, most of these lines do this, it goes da-da, 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 and then you pause, da-da, 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 pause, da-da, 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 pause, da-da, da-da, da-da. But when it's not end stopped, like this line, lines 7 and 8, do you see that? There's no comma and there's no natural pause at the end of curl. You read through the ending. Do you see what I'm saying? So let me read that stanza for you the way that you would read it. You would say, I met a little cottage girl. She was 8 years old, she said. Her hair was thick with many a curl that clustered round her head. Do you see? You just keep moving through the end of the line. What's that called? That's called enjambment. That's an enjambed line, like a door jam. Like you're moving from one, you know what a door jam is? The little thing at the bottom of the door? It's called a jam, J-A-M-B. You sort of move from one line into the other like you move from one room into the other. Step over the jam, so it's enjambed, okay? And a line that stops right at the end is end stopped. Does anybody know what it's called when you cut a line in the middle? Where a line has a break in the middle of the line, like this one? Right there?
Her eyes were fair and very fair, where you pause in the middle of the line. Does anybody know what that's called? Don't be shy. That's called a caesura. Right? Well, the way to remember that is that if you've ever known anybody like your teacher, who didn't come naturally out of his mommy, but had to be cut out of her stomach, that's called a caesarean section. It means to cut. Same root as scissors. Right? I'm very upset about that, by the way. I did not get to come naturally out. Seriously, there's no real reason to not have me be just come out naturally. Back then, they thought if a woman had one caesarean section, she should, all her babies had to be caesarean after that. But it's not even true. And I didn't get my natural birth into the world. I'm still mad about it. And I should get over it. Caesura, okay? What does it mean to have a caesura, a cut in the line? It's not like it's super violent, because all poems have that, but it just means that it changes the rhythm. And when you're listening to a poem, it's just like listening to a song. And if you're listening to a song, and it suddenly has a place where there's no lyrics, or half a measure where there should be a full measure, or the drums come in with a drum beat or a syncopation. That's all it is. It's a syncopation. It's a change. You know, just it's just a change in the line. So you can just like mark it and think about how it feels different than if there were no scissors. Okay?
All right, so I'll read the first one. We'll go here, Caleb, Max, Ilya?
Elena,
and then Kristen, sorry. All right. And I'm not even going to talk about why the first line looks like that. It's just a long, long story. I will tell you one thing about it. That whole first stanza is written by Coleridge, not by Wordsworth. So what's the year on this poem? Is it 1798? The end is right here, okay? So forever gets to that. It's like that one. Wordsworth goes out for a walk in the morning. Comes back. Coleridge and Wordsworth's sister is at their cottage in, I think it would have been Alfoxden at this point. Walk back in, he walks back in and he goes, "I've written a poem. Would you like to hear it?" And he just recites the whole freaking thing, you know, in memory.
Because he's walked along, and he's written the whole poem. He says, "I met a little cottage girl. She was, you know," he says the whole thing. And Coleridge goes, "That's good, my man. I like that. It needs an opening stanza." And he writes the opening stanza down on a sheet of paper, and he's like, "Okay, good. That's the opening stanza." That's why it doesn't fit, though, by the way. It doesn't fit the rest of the poem. It doesn't. But it's cool, because it's like, forgive me, but this is what the Beatles did too, right? So it's like Lennon would write the main part of the song, and then McCartney would come in and write the bridge, or the middle eight. That's why they sound different. If you listen to Beatles songs, and then suddenly there's something in three-quarter time, you're like, you know, it's just coming along, going, try to say it my way, blah blah blah, pop 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 pop, and then you get this weird thing that goes, "Life is very strange, and there's no time for fussing and fighting, my friends. Where did you come from?" You know, that's John Lennon, right? So that's the beauty of having like one more straight guy like Wordsworth and one more out guy like Coleridge. Okay, shut up, David. Okay, go. "A simple child that lightly draws its breath and feels its life in every limb, what should it know of death?"
"I met a little cottage girl. She was 8 years old," she said. Her hair was thick with many a curl that clustered round her head. "She had a rustic woodland air, and she was wildly clad. Her eyes were fair, and very fair. Her beauty made me glad."
"Sisters and brothers, little maid, how many may you be?" "How many? 7 in all," she said, and wondering looked at me.
"And where are they, I pray you tell?" She answered, "7 are we, and 2 of us at Conway dwell, and 2 are gone to sea."
"2 of us in the churchyard lie, my sister and my brother, and in the churchyard cottage I dwell near them with my mother."
"You say that 2 are on my dwell, and 2 are gone to sea, that ye are 7, I pray you tell, sweet maid, how this may be."
Then did the little mermaid, her
the Lord made people lie.
I'm sorry, that was so brilliant. That was so brilliant. The Little Mermaid. Okay. Disney just bought the rights to this poem. I just want you to know that. Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry. That was so wonderful. Go ahead.
Then did the little maid reply, seven boys and girls are we. Two of us in the churchyard lie beneath the churchyard tree.
You run about, my little maid, your limbs they are alive. If two are in the churchyard laid, then ye are only five.
Their graves are green, they may be seen. The little maid replied, 12 steps or more from my mother's door, and they are side by side.
My stockings there I often knit, my handkerchief there I hem. And there upon the ground I sit and sing a song to them.
And often after sunset, sir, when it is light and fair, I take my little porringer and eat my supper there.
The first that died was Sister Jane, in bed she moaning lay, till God released her of her pain, and then she went away.
So in churchyard she was laid, and when the grass was dry, together round her grave we played, my brother John and I.
And when the ground was wet with snow, and I could run and slide, my brother John was forced to go, and he lies by her side.
How many are you
then?
If they too are in heaven, quick was the little maid's reply, O Master, you're seven.
But they are dead, those two are dead, their spirits are in heaven. Was throwing words away, for still the little maid would have her will, and said, Nay, we are seven.
Excellent. Thank you, guys. That was great. What a twisted poem this is.
Like a little poem of like, it's like low key comedies, right? You know, like, oh no, dead! Siblings are dead! I don't care if you talk to them, you crazy little girl. They're dead! Can't you count? Right? I love this poem. Mm-hmm. Alright, so here are my questions. Does this poem comport to Wordsworth's three rules of poetry? Remember? That he had for this collection. Written in the everyday speech about situations in everyday life and spontaneous overflow of powerful emotions. Now, I've already told you it comported to the last because you wrote it on a walk. Right? So, yeah. So what about the other ones? Yeah, Lane.
Well, as for the situations from everyday life, like it was pretty common.
Yeah.
So this is something that like a lot of people dealt with, and it was a pretty common.
Sure. Topic. Wordsworth himself, his brother died. You know, we're gonna actually Wordsworth's family did pretty darn well for themselves. Coleridge lost his son, though. Coleridge lost Berkeley. Died his son Berkeley. Yeah. Other people. What about language of everyday men? Yeah.
I'm assuming because since we can read this today,
yeah.
it's written in the common language. But what did the highbrow language look like if this is common? Was like the highbrow language like French or?
No. It was still in English. I mean, it's more like what we read in the poem. So it affected. I don't know. I'm trying to think about how to talk about this, but. The terms ye and thou and all of those things, they might still be used, especially in the country where he was, in the North Country. They were probably not used nearly as much in London, right? But I think that if you look at his prose, you'll see that that's not written in the language of everyday men, right? So that would be one way to think about it. Like, he's writing that. This is the same person who wrote this, right? Most people don't say, I cannot, however, be insensible of the present outcry against the triviality and meanness, both of thought and language, which some of my contemporaries have occasionally introduced into their metrical compositions, and I acknowledge that this defect, but you see what I'm saying? That's not the language of everyday men. And if you write poetry in that language, sure, you can't do it. You can't. It's not going to work. So I think that's what he's talking about. But a little bit, whenever you have a new a new kind of manifesto, and you're going to do things differently than everybody else,
it's a little bit of a cheat. You set up a straw man, you know what I mean? Like, he says, we're not going to write language like those guys. And then he writes, and really, they didn't write language that, whatever. It's sort of like, if you excuse the expression, Republicans and Democrats, you know, having a little wars amongst them, you know, they're basically, they're doing a lot of the same things, right? You know, they're doing a lot of the same things. But you have to set that up. You have to set it up as like, I'm different than that. But I think this poem does it. I think this poem, of the poems in the lyrical ballads, this one especially, really has that feel. There's no like multi-syllabic necessary word, right? Anybody else about this? I invite you to write about this poem if you want to. It's one that a lot of people have chosen to write about, but I invite you not to write about it too, because a lot of people have written about it, but whatever you want. Let's see if I can turn this around. I don't know why it looks like that. A Slumber Did My Spirit Seal. Well, you've got this. So just turn to A Slumber Did My Spirit Seal in your packet. For some reason, it's all blue. I don't know why it turned out all blue. I just let it stay blue. All right, let's see if I used to have this. I used to have this one memorized. Okay. A slumber did my spirit seal. She had no human fears. She seen the thing that could not feel the touch of earthly years. No motion has she now, no force. She neither hears nor sees. Wraps round in earth's diurnal course with rocks and stones and trees. All right, so this is a very different poem than the one we just looked at. How is it different? All right, somebody beside you, because you're calling, I'm calling on you a lot. Somebody else, how is it different? Yes, tell me your name.
Ian.
How's it different?
Lot shorter.
Lot shorter, absolutely, right? Just two stanzas. Two, and remember, this is again, ballad measure. Da 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 da. And do you remember how this is revolutionary for its time? Do you use ballad measure in this way? It brings something very high, like this kind of philosophical poem that's really dealing with some complex ideas of what happens when you die, and it brings it down with a low form, which is a ballad, which was used for the masses. Right? Remember, the masses can remember ballads because even if you weren't like me, I can remember this poem. The reason I can remember it so easily is that it has that da 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 da. Okay, good. Ian, somebody else. How is it different? It's much shorter. Yes.
And the other one, there was some dialogue.
Yeah. Tell me your name.
Josh.
Yeah, dialogue in the other poem, more of a kind of like story. This one sort of just drops you into it. What happened? A slumber did my spirit seal. I've known this poem for longer than most of you have been alive, than all of you have been alive. I've known this poem. And I still don't exactly know what that line means. I think it means that my spirit was basically sort of dead. It's sort of strange that my spirit wasn't alive or awake. I didn't wake up until I realized that people could die. And when I realized people could die, somehow now I'm awake. I thought that young people especially, like, this is one of several poems he wrote that are called Lucy poems. Supposedly there was a girl in the village, maybe, named Lucy, and he maybe wrote these poems about her. It's not like twisted or weird, I don't think he even met her, but just like the idea that this little, like the other little cottage girl, that there could be like a little person who dies. I think it's all in Wordsworth's head, but anyway, he came up with this poem about somebody who died. Nobody can figure out why he wrote it. They all loved it. And he sent it to Coleridge. Coleridge was in Germany. Coleridge goes, well, maybe he's thinking about his sister and what if she dies. And he's like, there's no evidence about it. A slumber did my spirit seal. So, okay. I think I understand that. And then it introduces her. She had no human fear. I have no human fears, I'm sorry. I have no human fears. She seemed the thing that could not feel. So right there, she seemed the thing. Now that's common, it's common in English at this period, occasionally, not always, to refer to a child as a thing.
Also to refer to a loved one as they. Oh, you dear they, right? You know, whatever. It's not totally unusual, but it's a little bit strange. She seemed a thing that could not feel the touch of her for years. Then you get the stanza break between the two stanzas. What's different about the second stanza? Oh, go ahead.
I'm just confused, like, is, like, the first part, is, like, their, the, what, Wordsworth's point of view, like, from seeing the dead body, seeing the dead person, or?
I don't think that there's a seeing of the dead body, I don't see anything of that, but, he's thinking about this loss, and it's in the voice, I think they're both in the voice of the speaker. But, the first one, I would say, do you notice anything different about the first one than the second one? What's different about the second one than the first one? They're both sideways, but let me get a neck pain. But look at your sheet and you won't get a neck pain. What's different about the second one than the first one? Somebody?
I think in the first stanza is A, B, and B, and the second stanza is A, B, and B. Is that right?
No, they're the same. They're both A, B, A, B. Yeah, so what's different in the second one?
Like the first one talks about the, like your spirit, and then the second one talks about like your touch and like the things you can see and do, but the first one talks about.
Yes, okay. The first one is way more abstract and kind of floaty and kind of intellectual and spiritual, and the second one's very, very material. Like she has no motion, which is no force. She rolls around when the earth turns. Diurnal just means that has like a sun and moon, right? A diurnal course with rocks and stones and trees. What else? You have Ian, so that's what you're going to say? Anybody else? The second one. I'll give you a hint of what I'm after here, because this is one of those bad pedagogical moments when I'm a bad teacher, and I know the answer of what I want you to tell me. It has to do with time. Yes? Yes, yes. The first is in the past tense, and the second stanza is in the present tense. She seemed a thing, and now, no motion has she now, no force. She neither feels nor sees. You see how they work? Or hears nor sees. Wrap around in our style on board, of course. So it changes, like, it becomes much more present. Something shifts between those two. Between stanza one and stanza two. Yeah. Any lovers of Emily Dickinson in here? This poem is, like, clearly Emily Dickinson must have covered teeth on this poem, because I feel like this is her kind of poem, right? very, very strange and beautiful. All right. Anything else about this? I'm tired. I really want to talk about There Was a Boy, but I'm tired. Get up for a second. Everybody stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Who wants extra credit? Do you know a dance move?
Oh, God, no.
No?
I can't dance.
Who wants extra credit and knows a dance move? Okay, go ahead.
I do not. This is
a double. A what? No, you have to do a dance move that humans can do. I know, but you're like an extraordinary, venerable person. You need like that old, like, yes.
My grandma did this one once. It's called a shimmy.
Okay, all right, the shimmy. Okay, so let's all do the shimmy.
We do the shimmy around.
You gotta go all the way around.
We just gonna really do, we do a little kick, he'd start doing a little bit like this.
See, I'm probably as long as this graph.
So it's one leg then the other.
Uh-huh. All right. Okay. I think, are we now ready, do you think? Are we now ready to do, I think we are. We've like,
Look at me, you're doing all the time. I've been tired of this my entire life.
It's amazing how quick those dance moves. We're all very impressed with both dance moves, but just in a very different way. Can I do that?
Yeah.
Okay. So the poem I want to do now is one of my favorite poems, period, called There Was a Boy. Actually, I love all three of these poems, but I really love this one. This is from a larger text, and this poem, so far we have looked at poems, this poem is in ballad measure, Slumber, also in ballad measure. Who can tell me what kind of form this poem is in? This one. I've already told you about this form. It's a form for, yes?
Is it
an iambic pentameter. That's the line meter. That's the meter. So that's good. That's half the answer. What is the form? Yes?
A romantic ode.
A romantic ode? It might be a romantic ode, but I'm not sure. That's the genre. Isn't this confusing? I want to like stick myself in it. I'm really tired of it. I didn't even sleep yet. What is the form? Yes?
Blank verse.
Tell me your name.
Peyton.
It is in blank verse. So this poem, which is called There Was a Boy. There was a boy, is in blank verse. It is in blank verse. It may be a romantic ode. It's certainly ode-like, but it's a little bit short for a romantic ode. And its iambic pentameter is what makes it blank verse, Peyton? Somebody else? Unrhymed iambic pentameter. Therefore, the blank, no rhyme, right? Unrhymed iambic pentameter. So that doesn't mean there's no rhyme in the poem. When rhyme happens, it kind of happens by mistake. There's no prescribed rhyme scheme in the poem. All right. There was a boy. Ye knew him well, ye cliffs and islands of Winander. Many a time at evening when the earliest stars began to move along the edges of the hills, rising or setting, would he stand alone, beneath the trees or by the glimmering lake, and there, with fingers interwoven, both hands pressed closely palm to palm, and to his mouth uplifted, he, as through an instrument, blew mimic hootings to the silent owls that they might answer him. And they would shout across the watery veil, and shout again, responsive to his call, with quivering peals and loud halloos and screams and echoes loud, redoubled and redoubled, concourse wild of jocund din. And when there came a pause of silence such as baffled his best skill, then sometimes in that silence, while he hung listening, a gentle shock of mild surprise has carried far into his heart the voice of mountain torrents, or the visible scene would enter unawares into his mind with all its solemn imagery, its rocks, its woods, and that uncertain heaven received into the bosom of the steady lake. This boy was taken from his mates and died in childhood ere he was full 12 years old. Preeminent in beauty is the vale where he was born and bred. The churchyard hangs upon a slope above the village school, and through that churchyard, when my way has led on summer evenings, I believe that there, a long half hour together, I have stood mute, looking at the grave in which he lies. All right, so the first thing, not a lyric ballad, not published in that book at all, written in 1805, published later separately. So some of the things still attain, right? It's still, I think he's interested in that spontaneous overflow, but it's it's not, it doesn't have that same kind of revolutionary character. In a strange way, that makes it better in my eyes. He's not trying to do quite as much, right? But there's something very weird happening in this poem. And there's a number of things I want to sort of get at, so I'm going to rush through in a kind of weird way. So I have said that some of the themes that recur in Romanticism are nature and childhood and loss. And you have all three here, right? Nature, childhood, and loss. So nature, what's interesting about nature in this poem is that, thank you, nature in a weird way, it doesn't really become visible to us until you have its opposite. In other words, the thing that comes before nature is culture. Have I said this to you before? Yes or no? Yes? Okay. So this poem is a perfect example of that. That when you get culture arriving, you get nature. And the main way in which this happens, and move this up a little bit. Oh, what did I just do? No, I didn't ask. Oh, thank you. What the main way that this happens is with this thing called the enclosure. Oops. Enclosure acts. And these are 1780, let's say, to 1935. Okay? Oh, 18. Sorry. I'm getting so old, I can't remember my century. 1835. So the enclosure acts. Does anybody know what these were? All right. In the late 18th and early 19th century, what they did in the UK was take land that had belonged to the king and privatize it. The land that belonged to the king was called the commons. So you take the commons and you privatize it. Now, when you privatize it, does it go to the working people? No, where does it go? To the aristocracy, absolutely. So the aristocracy, the upper class, just gets given all of this land. It gets fenced off, and it gets given to these people. Now, the working people, many of whom were like what we would call sharecroppers today, they would live on the land of the lord, and they would work, and they would give some of their produce or whatever they raised to them, and then would sell the rest of it. Now that was not available. You were on your own. You were now, guess what? Good news, you're an entrepreneur. Bad news, you don't own anything. You don't have the good land to raise your sheep on any longer. They could just, the best land was available for everybody. It was the commons. So privatization, same thing that's happened with the internet, right? With space, it supposedly belongs to all of us, is getting sort of chopped off, privatized. We don't get it anymore. It belongs to like whatever. The same thing happens. So it's a sort of removal. But what happens when this land gets privatized? When the common lands becomes private, then you begin to get these nature poems. Why? Because before you get stuff that isn't nature, it's all nature, and you don't have to write about it. Does that make any sense? Same thing is true. You get these great, like, anybody hear like country music or bluegrass music? Bluegrass music only really came about when workers, white workers from the South, had to come north for work, and they were away from their bluegrass country or whatever. They'd write these songs about being back home. So you only get that kind of longing, because longing for West Virginia, but you can long for West Virginia when you are away from home, or wherever it is. Wherever it is, Appalachia, wherever those great songs come from, right? You can write those songs only when it's gone, right? So that's the idea. So that's what this poem is coming out of. All right, let's go back to the poem for a second. We have this boy of Winander who is
so much a part of nature that Wordsworth addresses, and again, do you remember what it's called when you address an inanimate object? Mm-hmm. What? Somebody? I might not have said it. It's called an apostrophe. All right? So when you address an inanimate object, it's called an apostrophe. It's the address to an inanimate, dead, or missing object. And this is a very, very common poetic trope, right? Oh, walls of the great brick building that keep us enclosed, you know, it's like that. You address something like that. It's a poetic trope. So Wordsworth apostrophizes the mountains and the cliffs, right? He says, oh ye cliffs and islands of Winander, you knew him well. He's so much a part of it that he's like one, almost one with nature, right? So he calls across to these owls. I don't know how to do an owl, but that's it. No, I don't want a sad owl. I want a happy owl. Okay. Doesn't look like an owl, but like, whatever. Like, oh, that's scary. Whatever. Whatever that is. But let me. That's an owl. Okay. Jesus Christ. It's terrifying. So he calls across to these owls, and they answer him back. Right? But what else is speaking when the owl, when the boy and the owls are speaking? In the poem, what else is speaking? What does it mean when he says redoubled and redoubled? Yes?
Is it kind of speaking of like the echo?
Echo, excellent, excellent. It's the echo. So the mountains or the valley itself is speaking. It's echoing back. So you get then, you know, the cliffs also begin to echo into here. And you get this kind of reverb effect, right? Do you know this term? Those of you who play music might know this term, reverb. It's sort of like, it's a kind of echo where you don't know where the beginning is or the end is. So if you're playing guitar and you want to use echo, it goes, you go plunk, 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 plunk. But if you play reverb, it goes, it just kind of like sounds out like this. It's a spring reverb. So you don't know where the beginning is and you don't know where the end is. So it's almost as though he's so much a part of nature that just sound is just happening. Does that make sense? But then you get something called, I'm so tired, I can't write. You get something called silence. The owls stop responding to him, and you get something called silence. And then what happens is, sometimes in this silence, you can't, all of a sudden, in this silence, he hears the waterfall. All of a sudden, he sees. So suddenly he hears the waterfall. Suddenly he sees nature. And it comes out of this thing called silence. And the boy suddenly able to hear and see. But only in the silence, okay? Only in the silence he's able to see and hear. So what this means is, here's one of the punchlines, Romanticism tells us that silence is not the absence of sound. Silence is not the absence of sound. Silence is a way of being present in the world. When we do our silence in the beginning and we're meditating, you can hear everything. I can hear you shuffle in your seats. I can hear the sound of the projector. I can hear the sound of whatever.
can hear the sound of my own rustling or my stomach or whatever is happening, right? Silence is not the absence of sound. It is instead a way of hearing. And Romanticism teaches us this. It teaches us this in a very, I think, profound way. The last thing I'll say, then, is that this same, echo effect and reverb effect is present at the very end of the poem. Do you see how that works? When the boy is dead, now it's the speaker who is suddenly aware of everything around him. He is somehow at once in a reverberative relationship with the dead boy. Because don't you begin that poem thinking he's talking about himself? I always did when I read this poem. Because there was a boy, you knew him well. It was like, oh yeah, it's him. And he was a little boy. It's like, this boy was taken from his nature. Oh, well, no, somebody else, right? So somebody else dies, has this experience. So do you see how this works? I want to let you go, but let me just see. Okay, I think we're out of time, so I will leave it there. We will talk about Frankenstein. So read Frankenstein, and we will begin there on Wednesday. Have a good couple days.